Good afternoon, students. This is the last class of the renal system, and the topic for today is renal tumors. At the end of the session, we should be able to identify the benign and malignant tumors with their morphology and the microscopic features, and a word on urothelial tumors. Renal tumors are both benign and malignant. By far the most common of these malignant tumors is the renal cell carcinoma. Willems tumor is found in children, and there are certain urothelial tumors of the calyces and pelvis seen. The benign tumors. Renal papillary adenoma is the most common benign tumor and commonly found at autopsy. They are small tumors less than 0.5 cm in diameter, and they are situated in cortex. Grossly, it is pale yellow, grey, discrete and well circumscribed nodule. So here we can see either it is a single discrete, well circumscribed nodule in the cortical region. Microscopic examination shows complex branching papillomatous structures with numerous complex fronds, with no nuclear atypia. The other tumor in this category of benign tumors is angiomyolipoma. This is a tumor consisting of vessels, smooth muscle and fat. 25 to 50% of patients with tuberous sclerosis show angiomyolipoma. There is a loss of function mutations in the TSC1 or the TSC2 tumor suppressor genes, which leads to this tumor. It is characterized by lesions of the cerebral cortex that produce epilepsy and MR. There are certain skin abnormalities and benign tumors in the heart. The clinical importance here is because this tumor is susceptible to spontaneous hemorrhage and can be a surgical emergency. Now, coming to the malignant tumors. As we know, the renal cell carcinoma is the most common tumor of the renal origin. It comprises 85% of the renal cancers in adults. It is seen in 6th and 7th decades of life with male preponderance. It was earlier known as hypernephroma, but now it is clear that all these tumors arise from the tubular epithelium and are therefore called renal adenocarcinomas. The epidemiology. Tobacco, alcohol, obesity particularly in women, hypertension, unopposed estrogen therapy, exposure to asbestos, petroleum products and heavy metals. All these are identified as risk factors. Most of the renal cancer is sporadic, and there are certain familial variants observed, of which von Hippel-Lindau syndrome is one such, wherein there is a VHL gene in the development of both familial and sporadic clear cell tumors identified. There is another entity called hereditary familial clear cell carcinoma, which shows without the other manifestations of VHL. Hereditary papillary carcinoma, which is the autosomal dominant form and is manifested by multiple bilateral tumors with papillary histology. The classical mutations identified here is in the MET proto-onco gene. Classification. The classification of RCC is based on correlative cytogenetic, genetic and histologic studies of both familial and sporadic tumors, and hence it is classified as clear cell carcinoma, papillary carcinoma, chromophobe carcinoma and collecting duct carcinoma. Clear cell carcinoma. It is the most common type, comprising 70 to 80%. The tumors are made up of cells with clear and granular cytoplasm and are non-papillary. They can be familial but also sporadic. In 98%, there is a loss of sequence on the short arm of chromosome 3. This occurs by deletion 3p or by unbalanced chromosomal translocation, resulting in the loss of chromosome 3, and this region harbors the VHL gene. Papillary carcinoma, it comprises 10 to 15% in both familial and sporadic forms. The characteristic feature is a papillary growth pattern. These tumors are not associated with 3p deletion. Rather, there are trisomies 7, 16 and 17 with loss of Y in male patients in the sporadic form and trisomy 7 observed in the familial form. Here the gene for the familial form has been mapped to the chromosome 7, that is the locus for MET, a proto-onco gene. Chromophobe RCC. 5% of RCC is chromophobe RCC and is composed of cells with prominent cell membrane, pale eosinophilic cytoplasm with a halo around the nucleus. On cytogenetic examination, these tumors do show multiple chromosome losses and extreme hypodiploidy. They are like the benign oncocytoma, thought to grow from intercalated cells of collecting ducts and have an excellent prognosis. Collecting duct carcinoma. They comprise 1% or less of the renal epithelial neoplasms. They arise from the collecting ducts in the medulla. They do have several chromosomal losses and deletions, and histologically these tumors are characterized by nests of malignant cells enmeshed within a prominent fibrotic stroma, typically in the medullary location. So here the cytogenetic abnormalities of trisomy 7, 16, 17 and loss of Y seen in the sporadic, and the familial shows the trisomy 7. Then we have the VHL gene associated tumor with hypermethylation and inactivated mutated VHL gene. Morphology. Renal cell carcinomas can occur in any portion of the kidney, but they more commonly affect the poles, whereas clear cell carcinoma arise most likely from the proximal tubular epithelium as a solitary unilateral lesion. They are spherical masses composed of bright yellow to gray-white tissue that distorts the renal outline. So here we can see they can be single or discrete gray-yellow to gray-tan tissues which are seen in either of the poles of the kidney, distorting the renal outline. The yellow color is a consequence of the prominent lipid accumulations in the tumor cells. There are also areas of ischemia, necrosis and hemorrhagic discoloration. The margins are usually sharply defined and confined within the renal capsule. So this is the gross finding of the renal carcinoma, wherein we identify this as a well-delineated lesion distorting the renal outline with gray-yellow to gray-tan, necrotic and hemorrhagic areas. Now next, the papillary tumors. These are thought to arise from the distal convoluted tubules. They can be multifocal and bilateral. They are typically hemorrhagic and cystic. Papillary carcinomas are the most common type of renal cancer in patients who develop dialysis-associated cystic disease. As tumors enlarge, they may bulge into the calluses and pelvis and eventually may even fungate through the walls of the collecting system to extend into the ureter. These tumors also have a tendency to invade the renal vein, and they grow as a solid column of cells within this vessel. Continuous cord of tumor in the inferior vena cava that may extend into the right side of the heart. In clear cell carcinoma, the growth pattern varies from solid to trabecular or tubular. The tumor cells have a rounded or polygonal shape and abundant clear or granular cytoplasm, which contains glycogen and lipids. Well-differentiated tumors are observed, but some show marked nuclear atypia with formation of bizarre nuclei and giant cells. So this is the H&E microphotograph of showing clear cells with clear cytoplasm. Papillary carcinoma is composed of cuboidal or low columnar cells arranged in papillary formations. Interstitial foam cells are common in the papillary cores. Stromal bodies also may be present. So this is the H&E photograph of the papillary carcinoma. papillary renal cell carcinoma, wherein we can see the papillary architecture. Then the chromophobe renal cell carcinoma, which is made up of pale eosinophilic cells, often with a perinuclear halo, arranged in solid sheets with the concentration of the larger cells around the blood vessels. So these are the typical chromophobe cells, wherein they are enlarged irregular cells with pale eosinophilic pale cytoplasm with a clear perinuclear halo. Collecting the carcinoma, this is a rare variant showing irregular channels lined by highly atypical epithelium with a hobnail pattern. Sarcomatoid changes also can arise infrequently. Now the clinical course. The three classic diagnostic features of RCC are costovertebral pain, a palpable mass, and hematuria. The most reliable of these three is hematuria, which is intermittent and microscopic. The tumor may remain silent until it attains a large size. Constitutional symptoms such as fever, malaise, weakness and weight loss is also observed. In addition to all these constitutional symptoms, they do produce a number of paraneoplastic syndromes, which include polycythemia, hypercalcemia, hypertension, hepatic dysfunction, Cushing syndrome, eosinophilia, amyloidosis, etc. They metastasize widely before giving rise to any local symptoms, and the most common location for metastasis is lung, followed by bones. Now the prognostic factors, it is seen that the 5-year survival rate is differing based upon the histological type, the tumor size and the pathological state. With a good survival rate, if it is a multilocular cystic based on the histological type, and a papillary and chromophobe have 85% of good survival rate. Then this is the Robson and classification and staging of RCC. Now, that ends the tumors of the renal. Then come to the tumors of the urinary bladder. Tumors arising in the urinary bladder, they range from small benign papillomas to large invasive cancers. These tumors are classified into benign papillomas, papillary urothelial neoplasms of low malignant potential, and urothelial carcinomas. Benign papillomas are around 0.2 to 1 cm frond-like structures with a delicate fibrovascular core, which is lined by a multi-layered transitional epithelium which is well differentiated. Urothelial carcinoma. Urothelial carcinomas, they range from papillary to flat, non-invasive to invasive, and they can be low grade to high grade. Low grade carcinomas are rarely invasive and they may recur after removal. Increasing degrees of cellular atypia, anaplasia, or increase in the size of the lesion and evidence of invasion in the submucosal or the muscular layer is also seen. So here, this is a demographic picture showing a papilloma, an invasive papillary carcinoma, a flat non-invasive carcinoma, and a flat invasive carcinoma. These are the H&E microphotographs, which is showing the transitional urothelium, which is seen lining the fibrovascular core, and the lower thing is showing increased nuclear atypia, that means it is a higher grade of urothelial carcinoma. So the high grade cancers can either be papillary or flat. They invade deeper and they have a necrotic surface. Occasionally they do show foci of squamous cell differentiation. True squamous cell carcinomas are also seen in 5% of the bladder tumors. Carcinomas of grade 2 and 3, they infiltrate the surrounding structures. They can spread to the regional lymph nodes and metastasize widely. So this is the H&E microphotograph showing the squamoid differentiation, wherein we have the squamous pearl formation within the urothelial carcinoma. So thank you children. This ends the renal system. There is a surprise for you all. The coming up sessions will have a slide quiz. You need to identify the lesion which is there shown in the slide. Please write down the slide numbers and then write the diagnosis or the lesion what strikes to your mind after seeing the slide. So identify the lesion, write the slide number. So thank you children. This ends the session on kidney and the lower urinary tract. I hope you have understood the classes and the lessons taken. Any doubts, you can please contact me. Thank you once again.